Good evening all. I welcome everyone on behalf of MIDAS. This is a small introduction. This is Sindhu and I'm a senior structural engineer working with MIDAS. So I'm just proceeding further. We know generally the process for any bridge structure or any structure is like you have to do the modeling, analysis, design check and then Excel report, and based on the feedback in the Excel report again you'll have to update the modeling. So it could be an iterative and a repetitive process. Rather than taking to Excel report manually inputting everything by yourself and then checking whether it is sufficient or not, if this particular option to design is already inbuilt within the software itself, so it is very quick for doing preliminary analysis assessment and then quickly checking, and if you want to update the model you can quickly do so. So this is the key reason why we keep emphasizing on the design feature that is available within MIDAS. So bearing this in mind, we will proceed further to see how MIDAS will actually help us reduce time and effort when we try to design these things. Okay, so I'll just right away open a model and try to show you the features which are available. Okay, so this model which I already have, so this again is created by created using the steel composite wizard. So every if you're a user of MIDAS you might be already aware of this feature. So this is quite a easier and simple way to quickly generate the model file along with the construction stages. Construction stages in steel composite is important or is beneficial in for two reasons. One is whenever if it is simply supported beam, simply supported girder, then it is okay. Otherwise if it is a continuous girder, like generally in US scenario, if you see most of these steel bridges are continuous, so in those cases where your negative moment is going to be significant, when I'm talking about negative moment, so this time it is the composite slab which will have to resist the negative moment. So to take into all these accounts, so doing construction stage becomes important. So when you're considering all these aspects, rather than manually modeling the bracing, the connections with the links and everything, the steel composite wizard will quickly help you to generate this model file. So the basic thing is we'll have to give the span informations, we'll have to select the section properties, and then we have separate inputs for bracing, we have separate input for girders, so you can have different girders, different sections, like edge girders will be of different section, middle girders would be of different section, so all the differentiations could be made within the wizard itself. And then default loads, like before composite we'll have to consider the wet concrete load, after composite we directly consider the the slab being in composite action with the steel. So all these default options are available along with the moving load analysis which could be quickly generated. And then as I told, construction sequence also could be given within, so it basically saves you quite a lot of time. And not just time, like when you have similar projects in which only the span or the girder properties are changing, so you don't have to model the model from scratch again and again. You can simply give inputs in these wizard files to quickly generate the model. So this model was actually generated using the wizard file, so I'm just presenting you, and I'll just quickly run the analysis, and I think the analysis is also done. So I'm not even going to pay much attention with the analysis results. So you can quickly give the load combination. So load combination should be given under steel design. So here I'm just considering two particular load cases. One is for strength and one is for serviceability. So it is a little quicker to interpret. And then right away after analysis, you can just see the bending moment diagram. So basically it is a continuous girder. No, actually it is, yeah, simply supported. Yeah, so it is continuous in the construction stage. So we will see how the design for this has to be taken. Okay, so directly I will go to the design. So here we have two components for design. One is the girder itself, which is a composite section, and other is the bracings, which is just a steel design. So if you go to the steel design tab, you might actually note all these four options: steel design, RC design, SRC design, and composite design. So first thing is, we will concentrate on the steel design, that is the braces and the beams, that is the cross beams. So the first and foremost thing you'll have to do when you want to do the steel design is, like you might be aware, the code provides the design for these member based on the forces it has to resist. That is, for example, if it is a bracing, then it will have to be designed for axial forces. If it is a beam, then it has to be designed for bending and shear, right? So first we'll have to make these categorizations, like what type of an element it is. So for that, under common parameters, we choose modify member type. Generally it is default, but it is always recommended you make these changes first. So first what I will do is, I will just select those steel sections. So basically these two are the steel sections which I have defined, that is the cross beams and the bracings. So I'll just simply isolate them. So in this model, what I wanted to do is, I wanted to define all the bracings as a truss member or a brace. So I'll just quickly select all the brace members and select brace in the modify member type, and then just set apply. So you can see these elements are designated as brace, and the design for them will be, you know, axial check. So it doesn't check for bending or shear, it will be just an axial check. And then next, whatever is left is the cross beams. So I'll just quickly select the cross beams, like in case I want these cross beams to be different, designed as a beam. Alright, so I'll just select these cross beams. I'll just make sure I've just selected the cross beams. Yeah. And then I will choose the member type as beam and then say apply. Okay. So at any point of time, if you want to remove any of these items, you can quickly do that in the table also. So you can just click on this icon with the three dots. So this will help you to modify these member properties at any point of time. Okay, so this is done. So this is required only for steel design. When you're talking about composite design, if the section is already a composite girder, then you don't have to make any of these categorizations. The design, it is automatically performed as a composite girder design. Okay, right. So now this is done. Now under steel design, we'll just quickly give the code. So we want it as per IRC 24-2010. So additionally, we have one more option here, like if you want to consider the beams to be laterally braced or not. So for example, in these cases, cross beams, I think you can I want to consider them as a laterally braced elements. I'm not considering for the lateral torsional buckling effect, but if you want to consider them, you can simply uncheck this option. So I've just checked on this and then say close. And the next option is partial safety factors. So these are all taken as per the code. These are default values, unless if you want to make any change. Steel material property, it is pretty simple. So it's going to be a structural steel, and its FY is 250. You can also see other yield strength, FY2, FY3. So this is as per IS 2062, wherein your yield strength changes are considered based on the thickness. For example, if the particular section you have defined has a thickness of greater than 20 and in between 40, then it will take a yield strength of 240, or if it is greater than 40, then it will take a yield strength of 230. So this is as per the table 2, I suppose table 1 or 2, I suppose, from the recommended code. So these yield strengths are automatically taken based on the thickness of the member which is selected. Okay, so this is done. It's pretty much a quicker way. And then we can just proceed for code check. So before that, if I just want to differentiate, want to do the design one by one, like for braces separately, beams separately, I can just choose them instead of just, designing all of them together. I'll just choose the brace elements alone. Okay. So I just want the braces to be designed right now. One second. I'll just do a... Okay, I'll just isolate them. So only the brace elements, and I'm going to perform a code check for them. So I'll just check them all and then just perform steel code check. Okay, and it is done. It's as quick as this. So to have an overview, I can just simply check on this table. So in this table you can see there are different options like all okay and not okay. So it will give you a quick glance of what are the members failing or passing. So if I say NG, that means it will list all the members which are passing for any of the critical load cases or combinations. So right now I think all of the braces are passing, so we basically have nothing displayed here. And okay is nothing but all of them. So if you want to further investigate like how is the forces, what is the ratio and everything, you can just simply check on a particular element. To have a very quick overview, you can check on the graphic, and then so basically this is an angle section, and it will give you a very quick overview of what is the moment resistant and the axial resistance ratio which is there. Further, if you want to take it into further detail, we have a detailed report. Okay, so just click on a detailed report. This will quickly generate a Word format, Word report. Yep, so first thing is it will list down all the load combinations that are considered, and then a quick element detail like what is the length it is considering, what is the depth, thickness of the flanges, its properties are like area, inertia, moment of inertia. So all the basic properties are listed here, and then further design parameters like length, like your effective length, factors and everything would be listed. And then finally is the force and moment that is considering for design. Okay, and further to it, it displays the partial safety factors, and so all the basic information that is required for this particular design will be listed here. And first thing is you'll have to classify the section so that you can proceed forward for the design. So right now this particular section has been classified as class 3, that is semi-composite, semi-compact. So all the checks as per 24 clause 5 mod 3, it is done. So first thing is you'll have to give the minimum web thickness and minimum thickness for buckling, that is web, and also for buckling of the flange. So all those checks are performed here. I think I will just quickly open the code and take a reference to this particular clause so it is more clear. So this clause right now is 5.03. Yeah, so we have the code here. Okay, I'll just try to keep them side by side so we can just have a quicker glance. Yeah, so this is clause 5.03 table 2. So you can also see that listed here. So it says clause 5.03 table 2. So first thing is classification. So based on first we separately classify the flange, we classify the web. So based on this, this has been classified as a class 3 semi-compact. Okay, and then further it is checking for the, so since it is a brace, it is directly going for the actual strength check. So first it is checking for the slenderness ratio for actual compression member, and then the check is okay. And then based on the axial compressive strength, this is calculated as per clause 5.07, which is for So based on the forces which the member has to resist, for example, if this particular bracing is resisting only compressive force, then it checks for that. So yeah, so design of compression members. So based on this particular cause, this particular check has been performed. And finally, it also checks for the ratio. That is, this will help you to figure out, you know, whether this particular section is effective or not. So if you see the ratio, demand versus capacity ratio, it is very less. So basically, you can, you know, try to reduce the section and, you know, try to save more material and things like that. So this is a very simple, quick design for the braces. So similarly, we'll also try to do the design for beams and try to check what are the results we get. Okay, so I'll just going to activate it again, and then probably we can just choose, yeah, these elements to design. I'm just selecting them and then I say code check. Okay, so again, I'm just going to quickly check. Okay, none of them are failing, so they are good enough. So I'll just go to graphic view. Okay, and then you can see all of them are passing, and the units are in Newton mm. Okay, I'll just change it to kilonewton meter. Okay, just repeating the same. So you can see again your axial strength, bending stress interaction, and combined axial bending in X and Y direction. So all of them are also considered. So we will get into the detail. Yeah, same thing. So the basic informations, and you have the classifications. So first thing for beam is like it checks for the minimum requirements, slenderness requirement for the flanges and web separately, and then it blows for the check, that is the class verification. And then it computes the axial strength, and then we have check for the shear strength, and then we have flexural strength about major axis, flexural strength about minor axis, yeah, and also the interaction. So this is how quickly you can do a quick check of whether the particular member is sufficient or not. So if in case any of the members are failing or they are not okay, what you can do is you can just simply change the update the member. Like for example, you can just go here, like go to properties. Yeah, so you can quickly go to section properties, add a member which is of higher section property, and then quickly assign them, do the design again, and then verify the report again. So this is basically going to save you enormous amount of time rather than opening your Excel sheet, changing the input every time and see checking whether it's passing or not. Okay, so next is we will go to the composite girder design. So I'll just to show you a typical I'll just isolate this particular section. Let's give you a model. Okay, so already we have a lot of videos on about how to model this, what how to define the construction stages, what are the significance and all those things. So probably you can you know, you can just write to me in the chat box. I can send you relevant links, like if you are finding it difficult to follow up the modeling process. So this is a typical composite girder which is available. So we'll try to design this and find out the results. So this time the design has to be performed under composite design, and you will have to choose the code IRC 22-2015. Again, the setup is pretty simple. You take the basic parameters. So if I'm checking, so partial safety factors are all taken by the code, as per the code. And then we are having stress limitations, like so with the updated code, we will be referring to the equivalent concrete code IRC 112 2011. So accordingly, the stress limitations are for quasi-static and different types of serviceability combinations. So all the different types of like characteristics, quasi-static frequency. So for all these things, we will be checking stresses, deformations, crack width, and everything. So all the options are also provided with IRC 22-2015. Okay, and then deflection control. So you can check for the deflection control. So again, this is taken as per the code. The default values are all what is recommended by the code. Again, this is used, this could be edited manually. So it is always, if you want to manually intervene and make changes, you can always do so. Again, we have crack width, so you'll have to choose the exposure classes. So accordingly, the crack width properties would be taken or checked for. And then we have this time we also have options for take advantage of the post buckling shear resistance of the web. So this again is available as per two, that is post critical method and also the tension field action. Again, this is up to the user how he wants. So if he wants to consider tension field action, he'll have to check on this particular checkbox, else he can just uncheck it. So for this main thing is you will have to, so for these two actions to be considered, you'll have to keep in mind that you will have to define the bearing at the support location. So if you could, take a quick reference to the code, just give me a second, I'll just open up the 2022 IRC 22. Yeah, so this particular clause I'm referring to is okay, sorry, I'm just taking a little bit of time. Yeah, so I'll just continue. Meanwhile, it'll open and I'll show you up. Okay, so we can consider these two options. Apart from that, all the listed checks can be performed, that is bending resistance, resistance to vertical shear, resistance to lateral torsional buckling. So this lateral torsional buckling, again, it is checked for two conditions, that is girder only, that is during the construction stage before your slab is cast. Sometimes it could be critical for the girder. So we are also checking for the girder only condition and also for the composite section. Like for the composite section, again, for negative zones, we would be omitting the concrete part as in the code. So those two options are considered. Again, then resistance to transverse force. Transverse force is nothing but your connection check, that is your shear connector, whether it is the provided shear connector is sufficient to resist your transverse forces or not. And then similarly, longitudinal shear, again, it is with respect to the shear connectors, whether the provided number of shear connectors in the longitudinal direction is sufficient or not. Okay, and yeah, resistance to fatigue. So this time we are giving extensive check for the fatigue. That is, we'll be checking the stresses at each point, each critical point of the section, that is near the junction of the web and the flange, the tip of the, left top right of the flange. So all the critical positions will be extracting the stresses and be checking against the fatigue resistance that is offered. And then serviceability limit state, we'll check for the stress limit. We are checking for longitudinal shear. Again, the code provides serviceability check also for the shear connector sufficiency. And then deflection check is there, deflection control, and also the crack width. So all of them are available as per 2015. Okay. And then further design material. So again, this is simple. The You just have to define what material you want, steel material, and what is the composite, that is what is the slab property along with the rebar. Okay, and so this is again the same like I explained previously. The change in Fy as per the thickness would be automatically taken. So you can see Fy1, Fy2 and Fy3 listed. So accordingly the yield strengths are taken based on the thickness of the section. And then is longitudinal reinforcement. So if you are generated using the wizard, so this is already given during when you're building the wizard itself. So I've given a slab with a reinforced at top and bottom, and then we have design position. So this position will basically tell you what are the elements I want to design. So you can either choose them all, or if you're just interested in particular elements like particular locations, like if you want to design every 1/4 or mid and end, so you can just select those elements which you want to design. So this will basically reduce the time. So if you are having so many elements and if you want to generate the report for all of these elements, it might be a little time consuming. So you can just, you know, if you want to do a quick check, you can just select a particular element and then provide and just say apply. So only that particular element will be designed. And then design position for output. Again, this option is if you want to extract Excel report, you'll have to select that particular element over here. So here I'm just selecting one element, that is 117. So I just wanted to reduce the time which takes to generate the report. So I'm just choosing that particular element. And then shear connector. So for shear connector, these are some of the inputs that will be required for the check. So those will be the number of connectors, and then the static strength of the connector, the diameter of the connector, the height, and then the center-center distance in the transverse direction, spacing. Spacing SC is basically the longitudinal direction. And then fatigue, what is the fatigue, nominal fatigue strength, which is for the connector. So this is basically the longitudinal shear check in the SLS case. And then transverse reinforcement, which is actually given in the slab. So if you note in the reinforcement data, we'll be giving only longitudinal rebars. So we don't have option to give the transverse rebars. So we will need it as a manual input from the user. And then length of the shear plane. So if you have gone through the code, you would notice that all these parameters are important in order to perform all the checks. So yeah. Okay, and then we go for next option is the transverse stiffness. So again, coming to transverse stiffness, we can give two types of stiffness, that is the web stiffener and the bearing stiffness. And apart from this, we are also performing a check for the sufficiency of the stiffness, like different all the checks like buckling, crushing and everything we are checking. So you can either give a flat stiffener or a T-type stiffener. And it could be a single stiffener, that is a stiffener at only one side of the web, stiffener at both the sides of the web. All this could be given. You can give a different material property, and you'll have to give the pitch and the dimensions for the stiffener properties. Similarly, bearing stiffness will also have to be given. So please bear in mind, like if you want to consider the post buckling effects of the web, you will have to definitely have to give a bearing stiffener at the support location. For example, this particular node, for example, let's say this particular element which I'm pointing with mouse, say the support is assigned for this end. Say this is element number 1 and support is at I end. Then definitely for I end of this particular section, I'll have to give a bearing. And you might have another question like if you know the sections are changing, like I'm having different types of sections at different location. Then for each section type, you'll have to define the stiffener properties. So you'll be needed to create so many number of sections if there are variation. Generally, I suppose there is not going to be wide variation in the stiffener pitch. So if there is, then you'll have to define one more section to make that change. Okay, I hope this point is clear. And then stiffener at the end support. So this basically is all again important for your post buckling to take advantage of the post buckling property. So you will have to provide, you'll have to check here whether that particular end is a rigid end post or not. So based on that, only the tension field action could be considered or not be considered. Okay, so even if you're checking on the tension field action and if you're forgotten or not given that particular support as a non-rigid support, then again your tension field method is not applicable and your shear capacity will be accordingly calculated. And then for torsional buckling, again it is very simple. You can directly give the length you want to consider for the torsional unbraced length. And then fatigue details, again you'll need some input parameters, uncorrected normal fatigue strength and uncorrected shear fatigue strength along with a correction factor. And then we'll have to choose the load combinations. So if you're using an auto load combinations, all the different types, that is quasi-permanent, frequent and characteristics, will be automatically categorized. Else you'll have to categorize them accordingly. So based on the categorization, the stress, the deflection and the crack width checks are taken. So for example, if this particular load cases, then it will be used for stress check or the deflection, so accordingly it will be considered. Load combination type, again we have a load combination type. This is for shear check, because for a shear connector check we will have to determine your shear under dead load separately, under live load separately, and also for fatigue we'll have to define a fatigue vehicle so that we can use it for a fatigue check. So based on this input, you'll have to separately define load cases, load combinations for them, and you'll have to categorize them under these boxes. So only then these particular checks could be taken. Okay. So yeah, so these are the basic input. And one more option that I have already told you is the effective width calculation. So what are the procedure to do that is, first we'll have to define the span information. That is, for effective width calculation, the main parameter that is required is the length of the bridge, right? So what you'll have to do is, first we will categorize the girders. I'll just isolate them. Okay. And then you go to composite bridge, span information. Alright, so here you'll have to select that particular, and I mean span as in the entire girder, entire line of girder. So if you already have a support defined, for example, let's say, I'll display the supports. So this is a two span bridge. Okay, so if I'm selecting the entire span, and you just say add, so you can see here the span is automatically detected if the supports are given. So the first span is 24 meter long, and the second span is 28 meter long. So you don't have to, you know, specify them separately, but if it's a simply supported case, then you'll have to specify the girders one by one. Okay, and then again you can also specify whether that particular girder is an exterior girder or an interior girder. Again, this is important because your effective width calculation is based on whether your girder is exterior or not. So if I'm saying a local Y, so it says in a direction of multiple girders. So based on the direction of, for example, for this particular element, my direction is Y direction is in the global Y direction. So if I'm giving a minus local Y, so that means the rest of the girders are in its minus Y direction. So which means it is the rightmost excuse me, girder. Similarly, for the inner girders, you will have to choose both, which means you will have girders on either side of this selected girder. And then for the other extreme, you will choose positive Y. So to the left of this selected girder, you have rest of the girders. So this is how you can differentiate between inner girders, exterior girders and the inner girders. So this becomes important for your effective width calculation. And apart from this, if you note in the girder definition, you can see element number 203 and support is I-end is a support. Similarly, element number 232, J-end is a support. I'll just check on the element number. So you can see here, this is element number 113 and you have a support, okay, I think this is girder 1, yeah, 113, and you have an support at I end. And then the next element is, Yeah, so next support is IEND of 126. So let's just check that. So you have 126 and it is identified as a support. So similarly, and this is 142, it is identified as support. Great. So this is how the software would automatically consider the length of the girder for your two reasons, that is your effective length calculation and also for your lateral torsional buckling. So if we can recollect, we had option to manually give the lateral torsional unbraced length. So if you do not provide input there, so the software will automatically consider the length of the particular girder for a unbraced length. So basically it could be less economical, like in case if you are not having a cross beam. So that is one option. Other option is like if say there is cross beams, cross girders which are coming in between, like for example, let's say at this particular location, that is under 117, there is a cross beam which is coming and you want to automatically consider the distance between them for the laterally unbraced length. So you can simply change this as IA, okay, change this as a support. So what the software will do is it will consider the unbraced length distance between these two supports. Okay, so that is one advantage of using this span information. So I will just choose none. Okay, so this is one important thing. So after this, what you will have to do is again go to composite bridge and say effective width, and then choose the code and then say show calculation result. Okay, so this will give all the effective width scale factors that are to be considered. So in this case, I think the slab width is not very great. So all the scale factors are 1. So basically all the slab is effective. If this slab is abnormally wide, then you can find a reduced scale factor. So this is basically to consider the shear lag effects in the slabs. So yeah. So and on clicking OK, what happens is these scale factors will be updated under this table. So these are the effective width, like if there is a change in the moment of inertia or anything, so corresponding scale factors will be updated in the particular column. So accordingly your moment design capacity will reduce. So that is the idea of the effective width scale factor. So you don't have to calculate manually again and give the slab. So this time MIDAS could automatically consider you the effective width for you. Okay, then we just run the analysis and we can just quickly perform the design. Okay, so yeah, let's perform design. Okay, the code is up. Okay. Okay, so once you perform the design, you can quickly generate the design report as well. So here is a report which is generated. So let's see in detail about the report. I'll also try to open the code, so it's a little slow. Okay, or just a minute. So here I'll just open them side by side. Okay, so first thing is just list down all the list down the partial safety factor. Again, you can see the codal reference IFC 22 table 1 and 3. So can you just go to table 1. Yeah, so all the partial safety factors as per this code is listed here. Next is the general section properties. So this is nothing but you just have to expand this particular cell. Okay, so this is the slab width. So you can also refer the diagram for understanding all the parameters here. So thickness, and then h is nothing but the haunch thickness, considering a haunch, and then FCK EC, that is your modulus of elasticity, and this is nothing but the reinforcement. And then you can see the effective width of the slab. So this will give you what is the calculations for the effective width, again based on clause 603. So here it is, it's not 3 2.1. Sorry about the delay, I'm just taking a while to open the file. Yeah, so here it is. So here it is, the effective width calculation. So yeah, based on the location of the element, the particular corresponding equations are considered for computing the effective span, and based on the effective span, the effective width is calculated, whether it is an inner beam or an exterior beam. So if you can recollect, I was explaining how to select a particular beam as an inner and exterior beam using the span information. And not just that, we have separate equations for a simply supported and a continuous girder. So again, the same classifications could be made by the software, and the effective width will be automatically considered. So that is the equation which is listed here. So next is nothing but a general input, that is the rebar detail. What is the rebar detail you have provided? It all this is tabulated. Next is the design strength for the concrete. So this is as per next 1.1. So again, this time it is as per, I think it refers back again to IRC 112. So based on that, your FCD is eta lambda FCK by gamma. So the calculations for that is again listed here. Similarly for a rebar, what is your yield strength by partial safety factor will give you the design strength. And then the girder properties are listed. And so separately, you can see the thickness of the flanges and corresponding FY, which is considered for your design. And this is the design strength. So here what the software considers, suppose if there is any variation, like for example of all the three, whichever is the least FY, so that is what is considered for the design check further within the software. And then you have the transverse stiffness properties which is listed. So these are basically nothing but your preliminary inputs, that is your section properties. And then it does a minimum thickness check. Again, if you can refer back to clause 504. So basically composite design, again it is part of it has to be taken back to 24, part of it is as per 22. So you can see the reference from both the codes listed. So based on minimum thickness plate thickness, it dates back to IRC 24. So if the given thickness is okay, the design will proceed. If it is not okay, then the design might not proceed, or you might be prompted an error message, something like that. And then effective lag, shear lag effects for the flange is also considered. It is also computed. And then these are the section properties, that is steel only property, short term property, long term property, crack section property. So all of them are listed for you. So you can have a very quick cross check. Not just cross check, you can actually submit them as your detailed report. So next is the bending resistance. So first is the negative flexure. So negative flexure, you can, yeah, so again first is the serviceability requirement for the web and the flange. So let's this is again as per IRC 24. I'll just open it up. So this is clause 509. So not 96.1. Okay. Yeah, so here we have most of the things. 0.1.1. So here it is. So here it gives the design check, minimum web thickness check for serviceability requirement. So this is this particular clause which is given here. And similarly for flange also, we have the serviceability check. So all these checks are provided here based on your transverse stiffness distance or your longitudinal stiffness distance. So all these checks are taken care. Okay. So next is the classification. So this I have already shown you in 2015. So it is based on your section. So we are considering all the four types of sections, that is plastic, compact, semi-compact and slender. So if you in 2008 I think the slender sections were ignored. In 2015 it also suggests an effective width method. I think as per amendment 2017 the clause suggests a slender design using the effective width method. So that is also taken care of. And also not just that, for example, if your shear connectors are provided in a sufficient distance, then the code recommends that any type of section could be taken as a plastic section. So we also have considered that particular clause into consideration. So if your you know, the shear connector if your shear connector distance is sufficient, then since it is being a composite, it can automatically be taken as a plastic section, because this is applicable because, you know, your compression flange is being effectively resisted by the slab from buckling. So you can basically take advantage of that particular case. So this particularly will apply for simply supported beams, but in case of continuous beams, again you'll have to make a decision when it comes to a negative zone region wherein your bottom slab flange will be in the compression zone. So accordingly you can choose, and the design would cater to the need. So this is as per annex 1. So you can just go down. So next is the bending resistance. Yeah, so this again lists you detailed how the calculations are taken. So this diagram is basically taken from the code itself. So how, what is the lever arm considered, what is the force considered, so everything is listed step by step for you for your quick verifications. Yeah, okay, so proceeding further, next check is the lateral torsional bending check. That is for negative moment zone. Even with composite section, we'll have to check for this because your compression flange is nothing but your bottom flange is not restrained. So we'll have to check for the lateral torsional buckling, and it will check for the rip first, it is required or not, and then if it is required, then it will consider a reduced stiffness of the bending. Okay, and not just that, bending resistance for steel only, that is during the construction stage, considering only the steel section, the lateral torsional buckling is also checked. Okay, so then is a vertical shear. Similarly, if there is a positive moment coming, then it is also separately checked. The bending resistance is also checked for the positive moment. So this is a diagram which is basically here. So for this particular case, the plastic neutral axis is in flange. So basically you'll have to revert to figure 1.2 of annex 1. So this figure is same as it's a kind of little representative of that. So basically it adopts this particular equation in finding the bending resistance. This is nothing but force and moment lever arm balance, force balance and moment balance. So this will quickly give you the moment, bending moment capacity. Okay, and then we have the vertical shear. So vertical shear again, first thing is we check for the plastic shear. Okay, and suppose if it is not okay, first is we have to go for a web buckling check. So if it is not sufficient, then your particular web is susceptible for shear buckling, and then in that case again you can try and see if you can use the simple post critical method. Again, it is applicable only if you give a rigid end post. So in this particular case there is no rigid end post, so basically you have no other option to just to revise the section. So that is what is listed here. If you have given a rigid end post, then you can take advantage of the buckling, that is post buckling. So you can see the softer computing shear resistance as per post critical buckling method or the tension field method if you have enabled it. Okay, and after that it looks for the interaction, that is the moment and the shear interaction. So if your shear is greater than 0.6 of the capacity, your shear demand is 0.6 of the capacity, then it means it's a high shear condition and you'll have to consider reduced bending moment. So that particular interaction is also considered, and then again axial and moment interaction is considered, and then followed by that is the web stiffness. So we have intermediate stiffness check, that is minimum dimension check, and the buckling check. So this is clause 509/24. Okay, and then for bearing we have web buckling, local crushing of web, bearing check, buckling check. So all these four checks are given, so all of them are listed in detail. Okay, and then is the shear connector checks. So for this we'll have to separate out shear force due to dead load around and live load around separately. That is the reason we have kept a load combination definition separately, if you can recollect. Okay, so basically the code calculates three types of spacings, SL1, SL2 and SR. So these are basically ultimate criteria, full shear connection check, and serviceability criteria, that is fatigue check. So of all the three, whichever is governing, which is suggest, it is compared against the shear distance you have provided, and accordingly the comments are given. So for this particular, the shear provided is not sufficient, so it is recommending that we'll have to revise the shear connection details. And apart from that, the transverse shear check is also carried out. Okay, and then resistance to fatigue. So here you'll have to categorize the load combinations, else you may not get the values here. So based on the classifications, you can see the stresses in top flange, bottom flange, web, at both the, you know, extreme cases will be listed. And these stresses, the maximum among the maximum of these stresses will be checked against your fatigue strength. So first we have the low fatigue check, that is whether you have to go for a fatigue check or not. So that condition is given, and if yes, then it proceeds further for a fatigue analysis. And then we have the shear limitation. This is a pretty quick check. So based on the shear forces, sorry, stresses, stress limitation, so based on the stresses it's all computed. Yeah, so basically characteristics loads or the rare combinations are considered for stress checks. For deflection check, all those load combinations you have categorized under frequent combinations are considered. And for crack width, again I think the characteristics is taken, so accordingly the crack width check is also provided. So this is for the particular element 117. So this is how we have tried to list down all the possible checks which are available. So I have also given you code reference here, so you can just quickly refer to the code to quickly cross check or cross verify the results. So that is much about the steel design and steel composite design that MIDAS could offer. So if you have any, not just that, after design you can also have them all tabulated in a tabular form, so it is easier for a quick check whether all the elements are passing or not. Okay, so yeah, so this almost concludes the session. So if you have any quick questions, I will take questions for another 2-3 minutes, and yeah. Okay, so there is one question. How we can, this question is from Mr. Sandeep Gupta, how we can connect the slab, the girder I mean, which type of material is assigned, what type of connection is provided again. So in here, in MIDAS, as I have already informed, we have a section, a separate section itself as a composite section type. Okay, so basically, unlike this is not a very detailed FEA analysis. So the connection between the girder and the slab is considered to be rigid. That is, it is strain compatible. Whatever strain the top of the slab undergoes, that is going to be same as what this the bottom of the slab undergoes, that is going to be same as what the top of the girder is going to take. So it is basically going to be a rigid connection. So apart from that, we have separately provided the shear connector check in just in case to check the connection, which might come in the interface. Otherwise, we don't have any interface or anything which is modeled for this particular shear composite. It just purely considers a transform section property for other calculation, strength calculation reasons. Hope that is clear. Does anybody have any other question? I'll also reply you privately if you're raising any questions in the questions box. If it is interesting, or if I feel if others have to know, I will try to explain. This particular bridge is not a simply supported, it's a two-span bridge, and it is a continuous. So that is why it does a continuous. I wanted to emphasize on the negative moment region as well, so I had chosen particularly chosen this bridge for that purpose. If it is simply supported, then you will not have a negative moment, and it will just give you checks for a positive moment case. For the modeling procedures, you can actually refer to our MIDAS India channel in YouTube. So previously we had given webinar on how to use the composite steel wizard. So you can quickly use them. And I might not be able to share this model because this is of a higher version, so you might not be able to open it. So you can refer that particular video, and if you have any questions, you can get back to us at this particular website. That is our support website, globalsupport.midasuser.com. So you can simply drop a mail to us. So like, if you want any links for any video or any other help, you can simply drop us and we will respond back to you in 24 hours. Post-buckling tension field action. Okay, post-buckling tension field action is actually one of the features which is recommended by the code. So this is basically to take advantage of the buckling, after buckling. So you know, web, suppose let's say a particular web is buckling. Generally it is like, once we say steel is buckled, we try to ignore it. Like, you know, you say it is failing. But instead of that, the code, there is a phenomena called the tension field action by which this buckling, if it is taking place along the diagonal direction, it can actually, you know, behave like a strut and tie model, and add, give you strength. So in order to take this particular behavior in for advantage, there has been several researchers, and empirical formulas has been derived at under this tension field action, which can be taken advantage of. But this particular, that is the diagonal buckling, that could happen only if you have a bearing stiffness at the end support. That is, you have to have a very rigid end panel. So that is the reason mainly I was emphasizing previously, like, you'll have to give a bearing at the support location. So only then you can take advantage of this tension field action. So that is what I can brief you about the tension. Hope it is clear. So, but unfortunately we do not support connection design yet in MIDAS, so splicing design might not be possible. So it is only for the girder design, and that's why we have tried to provide the stiffener design, stiffener check.